Greetings, Earthlings. This is a kind of follow-up video to Coen's inbox review of Tamiya's Dragon Wagon that he made a couple of days ago. There was some talk there of Tamiya's FAMO kit, and I thought I'd drag this one out of the stash and give you a quick look at it. And this is a kit in question. It came out 2 years after the Dragon Wagon. The Dragon Wagon was kind of a bolt out of the blue and very, very fine kit and great surprise to everybody. The following year, Tamiya actually came out with this, which was the FAMO 18-ton half-track on its own. And the lovely kit was very highly regarded. And there was some kind of question as to whether Tamiya was going to do something like come out with a new big tank transporter or tank recovery vehicle every year. And it kind of did, but basically all they really did was add a trailer to that kit and make a new version of it. So without further ado, look inside. First of all, I think I should explain how this thing works, because it's not at all obvious. Let's see if I can just focus on this for you for a sec. And let's zoom in. Excuse me. Right. Tamiya very thoughtfully add a description into the back of the instructions to explain how it works. Put simply, the vehicle is backed up to the tank to be recovered, and the rear bogey here is detached. Now, the bogey here has a cab with a steersman in it, whose job it is to steer the rear wheels, because it's such a long vehicle that it needs steering at both ends. This was attached to the back of the trailer by means of some very, very heavy metal chains with hooks that kind of hooked into there and winched it up where it was clamped into the trailer. So in order to start work, it had to be winched down manually. There was no power to this. And then this had to be pushed out of the way again manually, which must have been a problem on very rough ground or very wet ground. With that done, the FAMO was attached to the front, and its cable from the winch was passed through a set of rollers and fair leads and pulleys and attached to the tank to be recovered. And the ramps were taken from the trailer and fitted to the back to allow it to be pulled onto the trailer. And then it was winched onto the trailer, keeping it completely central, which must have been quite problematic. And then, and this is the bit I love, the rear bogey had to be pushed back into place and then attached to the rear of the trailer, which was then winched, again manually, up into position and then clamped. So that must have been a hell of a lot of work to lift a trailer with a tank on it. So yes, I'm sure that it was geared down quite a lot, but it still must have taken a great deal of hard work to do that. In order to ensure that the steersman knew what was going on, there was a series of lights on the dashboard, both of the tractor and the rear bogey, to allow the driver and the steersman to actually sort of communicate with one another. So I suppose it was, for its time, quite a sophisticated arrangement, but it seems like a very elaborate way to recover a tank. Anyway, that's how it worked. I'm not going to go through the instructions in much detail, because there's not a great deal here that's going to really be surprising. There is a nicely detailed engine. If you decide to have the sort of side louvers on the engine, you can see here that without them you could be able to see the engine, but you can actually fit these side louvers here. If you decide to do that, there's no reason to put the engine in there, you can't see it. So Tamiya even supplies a pair of little blocks to allow you to pose the engine separately. Other nice touches include workable steering for the tractor, which is I think always very welcome, as well as some quite complicated steering linkages for the trailer itself. These use preformed metal rods that are actually screwed in position, so it's quite a bit of engineering actually gone into this kit. It has rubber tyres for the trailer. I think these are the same tyres that are used by the half track. There's several places where the straps that hold these air tanks in place are actually designed to be cut out of strips of plastic card that is supplied. So it's going to take a little bit of modelling. Like Coen said about the Dragon Wagon, this wouldn't be an ideal first build by any stretch of the imagination. You would need to have a bit of experience behind you before you could confidently tackle this. So there's a lot going on. There's quite a few nice sort of bits of equipment, chocks and chains, and there is a crew. As you can see, there's quite a few of these crew members. A lot of them use the same kind of body parts. It's almost like the old Airfix multi-pose figures where they you kind of mix and match them. What is nice is that they give you a pair of painting call-outs, one for the sort of combat overall and one for training uniform, so the kind of the sort of fatigue uniform that was used. These figures here also come with the standalone FAMO kit, but the steersman and these figures, who this rather dejected looking Stug crew, these are unique to this kit, so you have somebody to sit on the tank and look fed up. Anyway, that's what I'm going to say about the instructions. Let's look at the parts themselves, and I'll zoom back out for this because it's a big old box. Okay. Some parts here for the trailer, mud guards. This is the front plate of the trailer. Now I have to say that there are quite a few ejector pin marks on these. Tamiya has tried to put them in places where they won't show, but I think it's inevitable that there will be some places where they will. I mean, there's some on the underside of these mud guards and things, which I think is I think you'll probably want to fill those. But these are big pieces, and it's hard to get them out of the mould without putting ejector pin marks on them. It's a shame, but I don't think there's anything there that's going to be a real problem. I haven't seen anything that's going to be a real obvious ejector pin mark. I mean, it's not like an Italeri kit where they try and get at least 5 or 6 ejector pin marks on every single part. Okay, these are two identical sprues. These are the ramps for the trailer. There we go, so we can focus on that. And there is a figure here as well. So lots of nice detail parts here for, these are going to be I think parts of the braking assembly. These I think are parts for the rear bogey. As you can see, it's a fairly, even the rear bogey itself is a fairly big piece of equipment, with again some figures. I'm not a great fan of Tamiya figures. These don't look too bad, but they're not exactly top standard. It's a nice sort of tilt here to go over the cab for the rear bogey. If you wanted to, you could leave that and have a model it on a sunny day. There's some very, very nice chains here. These I think are part of the linkage for the winch. They've been very, very cleanly rendered, very nice indeed. And these are the sort of the side frames with the leaf springs moulded in place. These are wheels for the trailer. These are the tracks for the tractor. They're moulded in what I always think of as model cast and brown, but they look fine. I don't think they are model cast and I think they are just Tamiya done in that colour. But as you can see, they'll take some clean up. They're not magic tracks. You will actually have to cut them off the sprue and clean them up. But it doesn't look too bad. And we're coming on now to parts for the tractor. These are. This is the winch assembly. The transmission and gearbox here, and the separate sprue here that contains the engine block. So the rocker covers and things. And these are actually the little sort of toolbox shelves that go into the lockers on the side of the vehicle. The moulding is exceptionally crisp on this. I bought this when the kit first came out. This is one of the very first ones into the country, in fact. So the moulds were brand new. But knowing Tamiya, they take good care of their moulds, and even if you got one today, it would probably be as good as this. The bonnet for the half track, or hood if you prefer. Front mud guards. These are the louvers for the sides. If you want to not have the engine on display, you can leave those off. What is nice is these are actually molded open. I don't know whether you can make that out, but actually the louvers are open. You can see through them. That's really nice. That's the dashboard, the frame for the spare wheel, and very large radiator cover. And there are some more figures, some torsion bar covers, lots of tools and pins. These are parts for the final drive. Oh, and the swing arms for the torsion bars. Loads of wheels. It's a German vehicle, so it has approximately 750,000 wheels. These are very nicely crisply moulded. There are some decals in here. You probably can't make them out very well. I'm not going to get them out of the bag because I will lose them if I do that. But there's some red and white striped sort of decals there for the warning stripes that go on the edges of the trailer and things. And another sort of main sprue for the tractor. Oh, there's a couple of parts already come off there. This is the sort of cab floor. This is the floor for the cargo compartment, and these are these bins here are the lockers for the tools. These are the sides of the cargo compartment and the sides of the personnel compartments. Again, if you've ever made pretty much any other half-track kit, then you'll be familiar with how all of this goes together. This is the load bed for the trailer. Nice single flat part there with sort of the subframes underneath it. Again, these will be screwed. You can see they're countersunk here for screws to go in there to hold the whole lot together. And there is a wee cardboard box. And the cardboard box contains lots of goodies, including the main chassis for the half track. This is a single, quite nice sort of stiff moulding. That looks very good indeed. The crew figures for the disabled vehicle. I think, I could be wrong, there could be they might actually just be the crew figures for the half track. Loads of nasty rubber tyres with seams through them. I really don't like rubber tyres, I have to say. You know, if you make kits like this, then there's loads of them. So that is a shame. You can replace these, but it'll cost you a small fortune because there's a lot of them. But you can get resin parts for these. Also in there, there's poly caps for the various wheels and things. Two metal strips. These are for stiffening the load bed so that you can put a sort of a relatively heavy tank kit on it and it won't just buckle. These things are linkages for the steering. Now, as I mentioned before, the trailer has working steering, and these are the linkages that hold everything together. Lots of little screws, which you need a screwdriver, and there it is. And there's some kind of plastic chain here as well that's used to secure your load to the trailer. Then there's a piece of, feels like about 15 thou plastic card, and that's your lot. So basically that is the Tamiya FAMO kit. It's I think a very fine kit. Again, like a bit like the Dragon Wagon, this is Tamiya kind of in their heyday. They made some very, very good kits around this time, and yes, they're expensive, but at the time they seemed like money well spent because they're extremely good. Personally, I think Tamiya rested on their laurels a little bit. I think that they kind of went from this to just churning out big cats, really, tigers and panthers and stugs and stuff, and they got very quickly overtaken by the likes of Dragon, who just built better kits. It's a shame because you know, at the time Tamiya was pretty much all we had, and I have a great fondness for them, but nowadays they really don't represent good value for money in many cases. I got this from eBay really fairly cheaply, and but I don't think I'd want to pay the full whack for it. In the UK, I think this is about £120 or something, which is about $180, or about the same Canadian. I wouldn't want to pay full whack for it. I got this for about £80, I think, and that was enough. I do like tank transporters, and I do look forward to building this. It'd be nice because there's quite a good choice of things to put on the back: Panzer IVs, Panzer IIIs, Stugs, Vespers, yeah, you name it. So anyway, there we go. That's a quick look at Tamiya's FAMO. Hope you enjoyed it, and if you have any questions or comments, then please add them. If you want to see more, then I can perhaps help out there as well. If there are other kits you are interested in seeing, let me know. I might have one in my stash. So if you kind of saying there's an armour kit that I'm interested in a look at, By all means, let me know. I can't guarantee that I'll be able to do anything, but it could well be that I have it in my stash. And if I don't, I'm sure somebody else who is reading the comments will be able to dig one out from somewhere. So this might be a nice kind of thing to start of kind of requests between us all of inbox reviews of various things. Right, that's all I have for now. I hope you enjoyed that. If you haven't already, please subscribe. And in the meantime, happy modelling and goodbye.